Okay, so Jan is professor in Trondheim. It's a specialist in additive manufacturing, and he's visiting professor in Stanford University in United States. So Jan, please.
All right, I'm sharing my screen. Just one moment. Do you see the presentation view?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. Today I want to talk to you a little bit about the aspect that Livio put out there, like about opening the design space, meaning that with additive you can potentially produce stuff that we couldn't do before. And for that, we also need to know what we should produce. And this is a little bit of the topic that I'm going to address today. But before, I just wanted to take the opportunity to present a little bit my group. We are the Micro and Nanoscale Design Group at the Department of Mechanical and Industrial Engineering. It's like around 6 PhD and 6 master students this year. We have like from 2017 to 2020, the time we exist, about 44 journal articles and what one patent. We got the Freenatech grant, which is, I don't know, it's probably a very typical scheme for every country. This is like the groundbreaking research grants on the national level. And recently we obtained also an ESC grant, so we are quite well funded. And also we are heavily supported, as Livio said, by Stanford University and the Vienna University of Technology, as well as other research partners. Yeah, first of all, let's address a little bit the issue that Livio told us. Well, what can be produced? What opportunities do we have? And what I want to address in my also like putting out a little bit of my research aspect is the multi-scale approach that we with additive we can do. So here in this slide, you can see the length scales that we are able to tackle with the same type of technology. It's not the same type of printer, of course, but it's the same principle with which we can produce metal parts in the 50 meter scale at least. So here you can see one of the bridges that is produced by MX3D. It's a laser welding process where they build the bridge in an additive manufacturing manner with two robots that approach each other from each side. So when they meet, the bridge is done. That's quite a neat concept for logistically demanding sites. And then on the middle, we have some other opportunities that also Livio said. We'll have multi-color, we have multi-material properties that we can just mix together in a digital fashion. And then in the end, we have resolution that is really unprecedented in terms of 3D aspects that we can produce. So here you have a race car that is in the resolution down to the 100 nanometer regime with so an overall dimension of 200-300 microns. So all of this by the same approach, selectively putting down material according to a computer defined path. So just to address this even more, we can see here house that was built. I hope that the bandwidth is large enough that you can also see the video seamlessly. So this is one of these logistically attractive approaches where the printer itself is smaller than the house, so you can put it, you can easily transport it and make this house on site. So this is a Russian company. I think it's already in business. But there are several others. And I think in China, there is a large scale approach to this where they really build houses in big scale on site with this kind of FDM of concrete. So what I wanted to address is you probably are all familiar with this term rapid prototyping that existed in the 90s. And rapid prototyping came from the aspect that basically additive manufacturing is independent of the cost per unit manufactured. So if you look into this chart on the left side here, there is a break-even point where in conventional manufacturing, you have economic of scale, right? So you more units you produce, the cheaper it gets. With additive manufacturing, you don't have that. So if you produce a few units, it pays out. If you produce a lot of units, not. So it doesn't mean that additive manufacturing is very fast in producing parts. It's actually quite the contrary. It's pretty slow. But the benefit is that you can run through a product development process in a quick fashion because you directly have the link from your CAD file to the physical part. So this link is the benefit of additive manufacturing. What other benefit does it have? And here we come to this transition of rapid prototyping to additive manufacturing. The other aspect what we have, again, we are directly linking part to computer aided design. And we are linking that part not only in terms of geometry, but we are linking that part also in terms of material properties. So the way you put stuff down also determines how your material properties will look into the end. So if we flip that and we say, well, we plot against geometric complexity over costs, then additive manufacturing is just dependent on this amount of material you put down. And conventional manufacturing technologies are not. They are getting quite expensive if it's complex. So just consider how much material you have to machine away in a complex designed CNC part. So, and at some point there is an asymptote, so you cannot reach the complexity that is reached by additive manufacturing, that can be reached by additive manufacturing. And here, this aspect we should consider, we should remember, because this is where we going to embark. So what is the real deal in the future about additive manufacturing and all the members of this consortium today will agree it's the final part production. And if you, these are not the actual data, but I'm guessing the progression will be exponential as it is shown here. Here we got the revenue in million US dollars from final part production in additive manufacturing. I think to note here, it is still low. In terms of total amount earned in production, but it is rapidly growing. And it's the most rapid growing sector in the entire additive manufacturing regime, which means this is a future potential. And we said before, complexity is free. Well, additive manufacturing only pays out for final part production if the if you leverage on this aspect of complexity is free. Now there exists some design tools out there since the 90s or even before additive manufacturing became big that are now gaining momentum. And this is because we have sort of a yin-yang additive manufacturing on the one hand side, requires no tools, requires minimal material waste. So you only put the stuff down ideally that you also are using. You have low manufacturing constraints, otherwise complexity wouldn't be free. The production time is dependent on the material used. Again, if your part is very complex, if you can gain performance out of a complexity, then it makes sense. What is, on the other hand, required to actually infuse complexity or infuse innovation in your product design is that you have a data-driven design approach that creates your computer-aided design with less design restrictions and an extended solution space. So here we go. In order to achieve complexity, we have to draw from a set of solutions to a design problem that exists. And these solutions, of course, that makes sense. If there are more solutions to a design problem, then likely that among these solutions, there is a better one. So if we combine these two aspects, additive manufacturing and data-driven design, again, we have this physical conversion. We have sort of a very synergistic combination. So what can we design for with this, this combination? We can design for a safe material, we can design for gain performance, and we can design for recycling or reuse. We are not going to tackle all of it today, but we are going to see how far we can get. So let's talk about safe material first. So here in Norway, we are very lucky to have a big company on this aspect of material saving that is called Norsk Titanium. And this company is located in Hønefoss, that is close to Oslo. And what they are producing is near net shape parts. So near net shape, it means that you're putting down material that is almost as precise as the part, that is almost the final part. And then you machine it down to so that it becomes the final part. Why would you do that? Why would you not make the final part to begin with? Well, the issue here is really the production speed. So in additive manufacturing, we said we are producing geometry and we are producing material properties at the same time. Just imagine if you have inaccuracies in the way you put down material, you will likely have poor properties. So this is the way we have to think about also here, because the surface is really poor in quality, it is poor in resolution, but the bulk of the part is fine. And in order to have a high production speed, we leverage on accuracy. So we put the accuracy down and then we just machine it. Where does it make sense? Of course, in the aerospace industry, where the parts are complex and where you put down material that costs a lot, for example, titanium. So here you can see the near net shape part and the final part of a bracket that is used in the Boeing 777 or the 787, sorry, I think the Dreamliner is it called. So this is one of the biggest marketing parts that they put out. So these machines have big build sizes of close to 1 meter, at least in one direction, and a layer height of 3 to 4 millimeters with a width of 8 to 12, and at the position rate of 5 to 10 kilogram per hour. They also produce nickel, titanium, tool steel, stainless steel, in addition to many other already on the market right now, and they claim to have very high metric tons annually in letting this machine run all the time. And what they really are working on is one parameter, which is called the buy to fly ratio. So here you have a comparison between different parts that are produced by different means. So this is a cast part, which has 0.7 kilograms and a buy to fly ratio 15 to 1. What does that mean? Well, that means how much material do you have to buy and how versus how much material is actually flying on your airplane. So rather poor in this case. So casting has 0.36 kilograms, buy to fly ratio that is significantly better, so it's almost four times better. Three axis milling is really terrible in terms of bite to fly ratio, but you can again get weight reduction with in terms of your legacy part and with additive manufacturing. Here, not near net shaping, but really final part production, you have significant reduction in both the bite to fly ratio and the material or the weight that is put on your airplane. So they have these kind of charts for different types of parts. So it's very part specific when this near net shaping pays out. So in this case, for this very specific part, this is like a cooling housing with cooling components, cooling fins. They have a reduction with respect to forged block and die forging in the raw material usage, like in the US dollar per kilogram. Raw material usage goes down a lot, but the raw material is a little bit more expensive for this direct metal deposition. The technology that they are employing, a significant reduction in the bite to fly ratio and a significant reduction in weight. So you can see the final part was 13 kilograms, whereas it was over 100 before. So this is one aspect. And the other aspect is to gain performance. And here we want to dive a little bit more deeper into when it, first of all, when it makes sense to gain performance, and then also when we aim to, what we aim to do and what is the underlying principle of gaining performance. And here, a classical example of gaining performance is high stiffness, low weight. So again, in the context of when it makes sense, we have to look into how much does 1 kilogram of saving give you is in terms of money earned per year. So how much money do I save if I put 1 kilogram less on this device? So here you can see a space satellite. There you have $20,000 per kilogram of saving that you put less on the satellite because it gets lighter, it's easy to shoot it up. For an aircraft, you have about $1,000 per kilogram. And here for this helicopter, you have about 100, and for a car, less than 5. So where does it make the most sense? Yeah, you would expect that it is for a satellite. Well, not really, because I said there are not so many satellites produced. So it pays out most for an aircraft, both in terms of volume production and in terms of savings per year. So there are a lot of examples out there where they saved materials. Not all of them make sense, but they are just like a showcase. So here you have a piston, which I said maybe it's not relevant for a car anyhow. For a rotating mass like this or a fast translating mass, maybe. For race car applications, here is a titanium bike frame. Might be too expensive, but I've seen companies out there that are actually building bikes by additive. Here, one aspect that really makes sense, this is an Airbus bracket that is currently in use. Then one other aspect that is also interesting is the eigenfrequency tuning, because as mechanical engineers, you know eigenfrequency is roughly K over M and the square root of it. So you would expect that if your stiffness goes up, if your weight goes down, you would also get your eigenfrequency up. And this is the case. So this code, this ways also approach is also used for eigenfrequency tuning of this antenna. Then here you have another bracket. So what is structural optimization? So what is the background of this. I apologize for the two O's here. But we want to look into what is actually the design domain and what is the objective function, what is actually our aim to do, what are boundary conditions, like what defines how far we can go in terms of our stiffness to weight in the boundary condition, where is our threshold. And then we talk about two approaches of how to get an optimal part, and this is the homogenization of stress level and then also the minimum compliance problem. But first of all, we have to understand what is actually topology optimization within the domain of structural optimization. Well, how does it differ to what is already known? So we have to clearly distinguish between the design variable and the state variable. So if the design variable is what we can change, the state variable is actually what we aim to achieve. So most of us are familiar with the sizing problem. So just imagine if you have to, if you're challenged with the task to design a bridge, you will intuitively know what is actually best in terms of a design of a bridge. So what you will do is you will construct something like that. You will think of a truss structure that looks like this, and then you will just choose the material. You will choose the sizes of individual members of this structure in order to achieve a deflection or a stress that is below a set target. Well, that we are all familiar with. That should be easy for us to do, but it requires us to know what is actually the best design. A shape optimization is a little bit different. So in a shape optimization, your design variable becomes the domain, which means that you can change the domain. You can you're not limited to a certain types of members that you have to define the thickness of, but you're looking into your domain and you're looking into how can I change my domain in order to create something that is optimal. Again, your optimum can be a certain deflection, and then the code, what it would do in this case, a computer code, it will change the shape of these internal holes that you predefined in order to get the deflection down at the center. Okay, well, this sounds also obvious for us. Yeah, it's just a little bit a design change of the internal structure in order to get a little less material in the center, a little more material here. Yeah, makes sense. But what is actually a topology optimization? Here, it becomes a little more complicated because here we are entirely prone to a computer code to tell us what is actually the best design. And how do we do that? What the computer can only perform tasks that we set him. So we are defining a reference domain. A reference domain is something that includes everything that you can potentially put material in. And we are setting a certain target, which means, like, for example, we want 50% of the structure of this design filled. And 50% of this design field means for us, we are creating a certain fictitious material that is 50% dense, hence gray. And then the code will decide, we'll go through all the elements. It's a finite element based approach. And we'll see, well, does this specific element make sense to my total stiffness of the part or not? And it will surprisingly come up with a very interesting structure that looks almost like our optimal design that we already thought we created in the first place, That's just because we know how a bridge would look like. So let's look into a little bit more detail. So a sizing problem is really defining on a cantilever beam, on a very simple problem, is defining the thickness of this cantilever beam in order to achieve a certain deflection. A shaping problem, we can assume that now we have basically a part that has a certain outer dimension d, and we are just defining the inner dimension small d with the outer dimension being constant in order to achieve a certain deflection. That will be a simple shaping approach. What is now topology optimization? So if, unfortunately, we do not have the possibility to interact much with this zoom, but what I would ask the students is, well, and here you have the normal stress. Let's do not consider this for the moment because it is applied on the entire structure. It doesn't really make a difference. But if you have a bending stress here, if you look into the bending stress, you have classically the neutral phase here, and you have also the maximum stress, maximum tension far away or most far away from the force or from the neutral phase, and the maximum compression also furthest away from the neutral phase in the below direction. So what kind of structure should I keep? Where should I remove material? It is very obvious to us that here we have the bending arm. So the length of this beam will matter, and also the distance from the neutral phase will matter. So the more I go to the force, the less the bending moment will be. And the closer I'm at the neutral phase, the less stress I will get. So what I will do is I remove the material here. I remove the material here. And if I'm still below the yield strength or below a certain deflection that I will set, I will remove material more and more until something like this emerges. And this is now my optimal structure. So the topology optimization code doesn't do anything different than that. It is working on linear elastic mechanics. We are all familiar with Hooke's law. We all know what a deflection is. We all know what a stress is. We all know what the elastic modulus is. So with the force, with the dimensions, with the elastic modulus, we know what we are dealing with actually. And we are dealing with this linear elastic regime here. So some notes about the stiffness now. So let's assume that F and L are defined by our product function. So which means your product demands that this force F is actually pushing this component down at a certain length L. So then we also set F, because that is also something that we have to define as a feature of our product, that it has to hold F. So on the top part, we cannot change much. So the deflection is mainly what we can change based on the elastic modulus that we can change by selecting the material and by the second moment of area. So let's go down the pathway that a normal designer would approach. Stiffer material. Definitely a titanium would be better than an aluminum. That is what we assume. Is that really the case? Let's look into something called the specific stiffness, the elastic modulus over the density in 10 to the power of 6 of square meters over square seconds. And we see, funnily, that the steel, titanium, and aluminum have almost the same specific stiffness. So it means that, wow, okay, that makes no sense to me because aluminum is far less stiff than titanium, but you have to also consider the density. So the other aspect is a steel of the same of 10 by 10 millimeter in cross section has 650 times less the second moment of area of an aluminum, though it has the same weight. So what does it mean for us? Yeah, maybe it's not the stiffest material that matters. It is the second moment of area that really counts. So let's look into a more utilization of the design domain. So here you go. If you consider a material that is low in density, and if you consider also making that material hollow, for example, this case here, where you again have the same area, but you have a 2,400 times the increase of the second moment of area when you make the structure hollow. So more utilization of the design domain really pays out. And this is, you can clearly see if you make a truss, for example, you have probably a very high directional stiffness in the plane. It is geometrically simple, but really how to get the high global stiffness is if you approach an orange or something like this opera house that has really only a shell. And in addition, that gets you very high eigenfrequencies. So if you consider that approach, if you were to design a component and if you were to utilize this code, you also have to understand what stiffness actually means. So the key takeaway here is use the largest design domain ever possible, because in the larger design domain, you can leverage on the second moment of area better. Use a low density material to maximize the second moment of area, and use the really optimize the material cross section. That is the most important. For our, to bring it back to additive manufacturing, don't consider only titanium as the material of choice. Of course, if your design domain is small, if you're limited by the amount of bending or amount of second moment of area you can put down, of course it makes sense. But if your design domain is rather large, which in the most cases it actually is, maybe aluminum makes more sense. Also, it is cheaper. So coming back to our theory again, we use the tensor form, which you're probably all familiar with. We have the stiffness tensor and the displacements of this of our cantilever problem, and the use the equivalent von Mises stress to look into the stresses at each node or in each element. So really Newton's law basically in a tensor form is what is built in into all of our design codes that exists out there. Now we as designers would approach this in a failure mechanics perspective. So we would do a failure calculation. We would say our objective is to have the lowest volume possible by decreasing the amount of elements. So by pushing the relative density either to zero or one of our elements, this is what we have done. This would be our objective function, until something like the yield strength is obtained, which would be a boundary condition. So here you have the volume, which is our objective function. We have the relative density, which can be either zero or one. Just remember that. It is gray in the beginning, something in between, whatever we want to set, but it is pushed to zero or one. And then we have the volume of the element. And then we can define our boundary condition, which is basically our von Mises stress with respect to the yield strength. And we can also define how fast the code is proceeding in defining a rejection ratio and an increase in that rejection ratio in each iteration. Our boundary condition that is also very important is actually our force and our also bearing. So this would be a boundary condition. The size of the domain would be a boundary condition. The force would be a boundary condition, maybe the deflection, if that should be also considered. So yeah, our objective here is really to lower the amount of volume. What this actually yields in most cases is some kind of Michael type structure. And a Michael type structure is, or a Michel type structure, is something that fulfills the Maxwell load path theorem. And not going too much detail into that, what we have to consider is that something is economic in terms of material structure if the space occupied by it can be subject to an appropriate small deformation, such that the strains in all the bars of the frame are increased by equal fractions of the length. So it means that once you increase the length of all the members, you basically have an increase in the deformation. So the increase in the length of the members is always subject to something deformation. And your tension value in any tension element will be equal to the compression value in any compression element in your structure. So this is constant. And this is actually called the Michael type structure, which symbolizes something that is optimal. So let's look into our code again. Here we have, we are gradually removing inefficient material from the structures. We're looking at inefficiency, low values of stress, strain will be deleted. So only what really makes, what is stressed has to be kept. We have a black and white rendering in the end before we have something gray. And we are looking into, in our case, in a two-dimensional environment where we create from a reference domain a part domain. And our boundary condition is really the von Mises stress. So we discretize the structure, we make some finite element on that, we remove elements, we increase the rejection ratio. As I said, the evolutionary rate is the step size in each iteration that you're doing. You're looking at if the stress is evenly distributed, and then you're doing the same again until you reach an optimum. So let's let our computer code do this stuff for us, and we can clearly see, well, the computer actually did the same as we would have done on the paper anyhow. So he would have come up with this type of structure that is optimal with a set rejection ratio. So we really reach a steady state if we define a certain rejection. If we change the support condition, we would have a different optimum, but also that we would have intuitively come up with as an optimal structure. Here again, you see a bridge, and this bridge is very much alike you would assume a bridge would look like, just because you know how a bridge would look like. So the problem with this is our computer really cannot do this very efficiently. Why? As mechanical engineers, you're probably familiar with the term stress singularity. So in a finite element code, you have on sharp corners, for example, here in this case, where there is a load applied in this direction, there's a load applied in this direction, on sharp corners, you have something called a stress concentrator, where one element or a couple of elements can approach infinite stress. That can be on a point load as well. Like for example, in looking into a cantilever beam again, it could emerge at the node or close to the node where the force is applied. So it could be on point loads, on sharp reed and corners of bodies, or point restraints, where this infinite stress is there. And this is artificial. So this means it only happens in the code, because the code only looks at some of the elements around it, around that node. So a manufacturing process would produce a fillet radius, which is not possible in a finite element code. And this fillet radius would have a finite stress value. So just consider the classical hole in the plate with fillet corners, change of cross section, this classical approach of fracture mechanics that also others like Filippo Beato will elaborate a little more. What is a stress concentrator? What is the particular problem of it? But what it means for us is, can we apply this type of stress-based optimization to our problem or not? In a normal finite element code, so in a finite element code that already exists, you already have a certain computer-aided design geometry. The geometry is fixed. So the code, the geometry that you put into the code can be considered, and the computer can consider, well, here I have a stress concentrator, here I have this. So it can do some kind of workarounds around these numerical problems to make a realistic calculation. Now, how does this work here? Let's look into the stress homogenization again. And we look into this beam problem again. So here we have fixed restraint, and here we have a shear force. So we would have singularities on the top and the bottom due to the Poisson's ratio. And we would also have singularities here at the tip. So we would have a fiber stress that is looking like that in terms of the distance from the force to the support. And in our finite element code, the FEA in the theory of elasticity in the fiber stress would be very much dependent on the number of elements. The more elements you have, the finer the mesh is, the more likely it is that an element that has a node close to it where the force is applied has infinite stress. So the stress is not always right. And particularly when you're designing on the stress level, so when you're decreasing some kind of elements, when you're throwing them out, naturally you would arise at in a condition where you have some stress concentrators just by the design. So stress is a problem, and therefore we are working on displacements. And how do we get from stresses to displacements? Well, we look into our Newton's law again, and we define something called mean compliance. And the mean compliance, C, is a force times U in a matrix form now. And if we put down our Newton's law here with the global stiffness matrix, and we define an increment in the stiffness, which means the stiffness from the previous round of iteration and the stiffness from this round of iteration, we can define the increase or the sensitivity of having one element more in the design domain or less in the design domain. How much difference does it make? And this is our delta K, and this is probably the most important factor, looking into one element and how much that element makes in terms of reducing the global deflection. After doing some transformations that you're probably very able to do, we are coming up with something called the increase in compliance, that is dependent on the individual element. And we are using something called the strain energy as our compliance function again, where we have two times the U, so the deflection of this structure, and the stiffness value of our global stiffness value. So how much does this one element make in terms of the global reduction of the deflection? So here we have a little bit of a different approach. We have the sensitivity number, and the sensitivity number is now our strain energy. And we have an element removal ratio, which defines us how much elements do we reach at every iteration, how much do we actually discard. So again, we discretize the structure, we perform a finite element modeling, we look into the element sensitivity, remove those with low sensitivity, and again, here we are looking into how much one element makes in terms of reduction of the deflection. So it is not nothing for the yield strength, is no failure criteria. It is really only looking into the global stiffness. The yield strength is not part of our optimization problem. And then we define some compliance limit, which is defined by us, so as users. And if that compliance limit is not reached, we do the finite element modeling again until we find an optimum. Okay, so usually I'm asking a lot of questions here, but feel free to shoot me an email if something is unclear. Doesn't work so well in the Zoom meetings. So again, our compliance function or of our objective function is now this compliance. And this is the strain energy. So minimum compliance means minimizing this strain energy under the certain boundary conditions. And here we have the relative density of the element. Again, the number of elements that we are going through in these iterations. We have the element stiffness matrix, and we have the element displacement, which we sum up to get with all the elements in the design domain to get the global stiffness and the global deflection. And what is very important here, and this is the thing to note, is that our boundary condition is the volume fraction. So how compliant your structure is, what is acceptable in terms of compliance, is defined by you as a user. So you said, my design domain should also only be 50% filled. And this is something that you define as the user. So as the yield strength is not part of this optimization problem, you as user have to define what is actually worthwhile in optimization, what will lead to something that is not failing. And this is something where you can say, well, that's a big bottleneck of the code, yes, but it also doesn't make you unemployed, because you have to, you as a material designer or you as a specialist in that area, have to really have good engineering assumptions to define something meaningful in terms of volume fraction. So the global stiffness matrix or Newton's law is a boundary condition, as well as that we have to push our elements to zero or one. So we would have thought of a optimization problem looking like this, in terms of if we consider our yield strength as the boundary condition. But now it looks a little bit different when we are talking about optimizing the deflection. So if you're optimizing the deflection, we would come up with something like this. And we clearly see what we can set as a boundary condition, as our optimization condition, is the deflection. So when should the code end? What is our compliance limit? And also the volume fraction. So both can be set, either of them can be set. You can see with lower volume fractions, of course, or lower, higher allowances in terms of deflection, we can get less material in the design domain. And overall, our structure would look a little bit more complex. And this is because a more complex structure, or like a more individual kind of struts, would lead to a lower amount of deflection. So a stress optimization is different from a deflection optimization, because here you're not considering how the material is stressed. It also leads to very interesting problems, which we will not go into detail here, with these types of checkerboard domains that have very high artificial stiffness. This is something that doesn't exist, of course, because you cannot make a material that looks like that. But it's something that the code does in terms of numerics that we have to avoid. And generally, we are very much dependent on the elemental removal ratio, which is basically how fast the code is, how many elements it should remove in each iteration. So you can see that the outcome is a little bit different depending on how fast the code is proceeding. This is because the code cannot build up structure, it can only remove elements, and those elements that are removed in each iterations are not there for the next iteration. So you're decreasing your solution space by having, and then your solution space becomes smaller and smaller until you reach the optimum. So likely, if you're taking bigger steps, you're stepping over a solution that is probably better. So let's sum this up for a moment. We have the compliance-based optimization, the stress level-based optimization. Just the thing to note here is that stress level-based optimization is possible. It's not that it is impossible, it's just very difficult. And for the 2D domain, it is certainly doable, but all the codes that exist out there that you will be working with are compliance-based. So it is important to know the difference and what this code can do and what it cannot do. In a simple scenario, if you don't have many solutions, it looks very alike. Besides that, you have some more complexity, which means more surface area or surface perimeter in a 2D domain in a compliance-based world, which we already discussed. If you increase the solution space, so for example, if you have more mesh elements, if you have less design restrictions, so here you have more design restrictions than here, then this code will definitely create you a higher complexity and thinner members. A problem with these thinner members could also be that buckling is an issue, but buckling is not considered because it's not linear. So buckling can be a stringent issue in this case. So we can have another set of discussions here, but it's probably beyond the scope of this this workshop here. But what you can see also, if you're decreasing the solution space, so if you're increasing void areas, for example, here, or more forces also means less solutions. In terms of maximum stress and compliance, you're almost at the same level. The more you allow, the more you constrain. But still, the complexity is much higher with the compliance-based optimization. So just for a summary, in the stress level, you can really distribute material to sustain load. It is subject to defined boundary and load conditions. It creates simpler structures. It's higher in computational efforts. And it favors a failure criterion, like, for example, yielding. and not the material duty to be distributed. So it is really, you can really put your yield strength in this optimization code. So it creates more realistic structure, but it is very difficult to define because of this singularity issue and the local nature and nonlinear behavior of stress level. So hence it is less popular. It is also not really implemented in modern codes that exist out there that you can buy. Rather than that, we have a compliance minimization, which creates you an optimal volume fraction as a boundary condition. So this is something that you have to set, and it distributes your material and as a result of the deflection. So stress and material distribution are set because of the deflection. It creates you complex layouts, and these layouts are very dependent on your boundary condition of how much material you let the code to work with. It doesn't really lead to actual prediction in stress and displacement. So you always have to do a finite element validation later on, but it is robust. It is lower in terms of computational efforts. And if you're ever approaching this regime, you will see computational efforts are of a big concern. Because you're running finite element modeling in every iteration. So it's really heavy. Hence, so the compliance minimization as an effective method is the most common. So how does this look in a real application? So here you can see both. You can see the optimization and then later on the stress level. So here, the stress is really only assessed after the iteration is done. And you can see that the stress is not homogeneously distributed. It is really high or higher at the corners or at the edges where the boundary conditions are. So at the loads, for example, here, here, and here, where the boundary conditions are applied, we have high stress levels. And this could be above yielding or below yielding, we don't know. We have to find out after the code is done. Here's another 3D example of the same issue. This is a little bit of a different code that is actually working on getting material, producing material and removing material at the same time. It's a little more efficient, but also more complicated, can lead to singularities. So also something we could discuss if we had more time. Again, the stress level here is a boundary condition. So stress level here is just computed after the fact, after the optimization is done. And you can clearly see very thin members arising from this optimization. What the code is very good at is actually looking into when you have a certain part defined, how much savings you can get out of it. And you can see in industry that a lot of tools or a lot of parts brackets are made optimized based on already existing products. And this is kind of the dilemma that you have here. You have to define, you have to know your load case very well, extremely well. And you have to know your design domain very well in order to create a part that is meaningful. So the more unknowns you have, the less meaningful this code will be. So you can question how much product innovation you can do if you're limited by a really very defined design problem. So here you have such a very defined design problem, and the code will remove inefficient materials very effectively. We can also see very clearly that the mesh size matters. So in the mesh, you can see in the surface, you can see that it's getting kind of rough. And this is because it it removes element by element, which and the boundary is diffuse, so you don't really know the ideal threshold between no material and material is diffuse. That's why the surface looks kind of bony. It is not a little bit rough, which is very much dependent on the element size. So you have to do a smoothing, and this is what these guys did later on. You have to smooth the surface in order to mitigate this effect of the elements. And you can also see that some problems like this become problematic or like intense very quickly. All right, so I'm at the end of my talk, but what I wanted to go through is also some examples of compliance modeling, and also something where you go beyond this compliance model, where you optimize also for fuel cell losses, for example, or for optical solar energy converters. So this kind of design principle can be applied to many things that have performance as a target. And the most critical aspect is always to define performance for the computer. So if you're more interested in that, also into like how to design and go through such a design optimization problem, feel free to contact me. Maybe there is time in Serum for a more elaborate walk through the area of topology optimization, which is a very complex one. With that, I will also put out these slides, and thank you, Livio, for your nice invitation. I'm happy to answer questions if there are any, and otherwise I will give to the next speaker.
Thank you very much, Ian, for your very interesting presentation. I will ask the audience if there are some questions.
Maybe I can say something.
My colleague, Angel Cernescu.
Look, you did mention something in the end of your presentation about the buckling, because I've seen that this optimization technique is based on the strength criteria and less on the stability. And you said that the buckling might be a really issue in this optimization. Because you might